joining us on the program for the first time since what some are calling the tizzy of 2015, the great kerfuffle. The, what do they call it? Was it the disturbance, Michael?
The fuss.
The fuss, that's it. Fuss Anderson. Madam Mayor Stephanie Rawlings-Blake returns to the program. Good morning, Madam Mayor.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Josh Spiegel.
Hi, Mayor. It's Josh. How you doing?
I'm good, thank you. How about you?
I'm good. So, just to get right into the obvious issue facing the city, there's been talk that a lot of police officers are afraid to make arrests, and that's part of the reason why the murder rate has shot up, the number of shootings has shot up. How can police officers regain the confidence to effectively fight crime and make arrests? How can that happen as fast as possible?
Well, we're certainly looking at all the resources that we have available to work with the officers to make sure that they understand. There's certainly some interest or some concerns around with the charging document. What does that mean for police officers? With the charging documents, we have the six officers. You know, what does that mean for officers when they're out there using their best judgment? And the commissioner has been working with the state attorney, the U.S. attorney, you know, bringing those resources into the department, talking to officers about what's expected. The officers understandably want to make sure that when they're out there using their best judgment, that it will be seen as using their best judgment, and they won't, end up as the target of an investigation, or to be arrested for using their best judgment. And we understand that, and we're working. Like I said, the commissioner's working with the state attorney and the Department of Justice on resolving those issues. Because what I want to say is, I think at this time where everyone's pointing fingers and scapegoating and looking for blame, what I can say is I know that the officers that have chosen or have answered that call to put their lives on the line to protect our communities, they respect the oath that they took. And I know that they would not, there's this notion that they're not working, that all of those things. I know that they respect their oath of office too much to slow down or to watch when this violence is happening in the street. So like I said, that this has to be a collaborative effort, and we're doing our part to make sure that the officers have the tools that they need to continue to be effective.
Just to go back to the beginning, and I know you've talked about this a million times, and you're probably tired of talking about it, but this is the first time we've talked to you since then. And you came under so much criticism on that day that everything went down, that you weren't seen publicly, or you didn't address the public for something like 5 hours. Do you feel like you owe the people of Baltimore an apology for waiting that long to publicly address them?
What I will say is when the unrest happened on that, you're talking about that Monday night.
Right.
Yep.
And you're saying the suggestion was I was waiting. I was working. I was working to make sure that what we had was just that one night of a few hours of unrest, and not the hours not the days or weeks of unrest that we've seen in other jurisdictions. And that doesn't happen by accident.
Right.
It happens because work gets done.
Right.
So while people are saying, waiting, I wasn't waiting. I was working. I was making sure that we were putting all of the things in place so this didn't turn into Ferguson when you have weeks and weeks of unrest.
Mayor,
we had in Baltimore before with the 68 and the riots, when it wasn't, on that evening we had, I would say, the fire department is saying 31 or 32 structures on fire.
Right.
During the 68 riots, there were hundreds of businesses that were burned. I was doing what I needed to do to make sure that we got that under control. It wasn't waiting.
Yeah.
It wasn't about a press event. It was about doing the work that needed to be done to make sure that this unrest didn't turn into weeks.
Right, Mayor, I understand. I understand what you're saying, and that's what you've been saying all along, but people aren't accepting that explanation. So, and as you know, in the kind of work that you do, appearance, appearances is everything. Don't you think you should have come out, just even if it was just for 30 seconds, to say, you know, I'm working on it, we're busy, I'll be out in as soon as I can to address this?
I don't, listen, you can't do a 30-second interview. In order to do any type of press event, you have to prepare for the press event so you can make sure that you're answering all the questions that need to be answered. My priority was not to do a press event. My priority was to do the work that we needed to do to make sure that we didn't have, like I said, the weeks of unrest, the hundreds of buildings or structures burning. We had 31 structural fires. We had hours, not days, of looting and rioting. We had hours of it, and we were able to get that under control. So you can say what you want about whether or not I should have come out, you know, for 30 seconds or come out an hour sooner. The at the end of the day, the results show that I did the work that was needed to make sure that this was a very localized event. It was a couple of hours, not days of looting, not late days of things being on fire. I did the work that was needed to get the
so you're comfortable. You're comfortable. No, you feel like you've done. You did acted and did everything that you did that you could have done, and you're okay with it, because the people of the city obviously are not okay with the way things were handled, but you feel like you did a good job.
Listen, I put on my big girl pants every day and take criticism. I have very thick skin.
Right.
I know what my obligation was. It was to make sure that no one was killed during these events. I wanted to make sure that this was an event that was a focus. The focus was because we lost a life in Baltimore at police hands. I was very concerned that we not lose any additional life during this interaction between the protesters or the rioters and the police. I wanted to make sure that we got it under control and were able to move forward. And, you know, I understand, because of my role, you know, that the things are judged, criticized, whatever. I think while you say that people were unsatisfied, I hear from people every single day that say, thank you. We understand why you did what you needed to do. You needed to get this under control, and you did that. So, you know, like I said, we didn't have weeks of unrest like there was in Ferguson. We didn't have the entire city burning like there was in 68. It was a very localized event because I did the work to make it so.
Madam Mayor Stephanie Rawlings-Blake joining us on the program. And during the events, national media descended onto Baltimore. Everyone from CNN, MSNBC, and Fox News sent Geraldo. And Geraldo came in studio with us and made a claim that I'd like you to either refute or confirm. And I have the audio in case this is from Geraldo. He said that he had it under authority from a friend of his that is a high-ranking judge that during the riots that you actually left the city and went into a gated community. I have the audio if you'd like it, but I'd like to hear if you can confirm or deny that during the riots, you, in a manner of speaking, fled the city.
I did not flee the city. I did not flee the city.
Okay. All right.
All right. Well, here we are. I mean, we had the riots. A lot of people, you know, were not happy with the way things went down, the way you handled it. I personally, for me, from the outside in, it seemed like maybe, you were in a little bit over your head. And did the governor bail you out? I don't know. I'm not sure. But so that all happened. And now we are under, you know, however far removed from the riots, the deadliest month in 40 years in Baltimore. I mean,
so it's difficult.
What is going on? How do we save the city? It seems like it's just spiraling out of control.
Yeah, because let me piggyback Scott's point. It is spiraling out of control because you've made some claims of hypotheticals. It didn't go on for days. It didn't go on for weeks. You kept the riots to that one day, but we are now a month removed. And sure, while their buildings aren't burning and the National Guard isn't around, we've dealt with the single deadliest month in four decades that those riots were the jumping off point. So you could almost say that while they're not quite as grandiose with burning buildings and images of National Guard downtown, it's still going on. The tension is still heavy in the air. It's still thick in the air to where, you know what, it seems to me that it is still going on.
You're saying that the homicides are happening are a result of the Freddie Gray incident?
From that point, then from that flashpoint of the riots up until today that when we speak, it's been the worst month in Baltimore in 40 years. And the point that you were making, that you were saying that it hasn't continued past that one day, but as a citizen in Baltimore, who, by the way, smelled the burning CVS through his bedroom window, it seems to still be going on in a manner of speaking. More people have died in 40 years in this one month than any prior month in that time. So it's hard to say, well, we locked it down to that one day.
Well, that's, again, I mean, you can mix the issues if you'd like. With respect to the riots, the record is clear. We were able to get that under control. With respect to the killing, I don't think there's been any other elected official that's been more vocal about the issue of black-on-black crime. And our need to come together as a community to say enough is enough. I made it the focus of my State of the City address earlier this year. I had the African-American male's call to action. I understand that, and again, while you're confusing these two issues, they're clearly different. I understand that.
How are they different?
The 200.
How is that different? The city burns, and then 40, and then 40 years.
I'm almost done. In last year, out of the 211 homicides that we had, 189 of those were African American men, not killed at the hands of the police, but killed by one another. And it was me that had the call to action to ask the community to come together. You know, we have to come together with information about the small group of individuals that are causing this devastation, that have the illegal guns, that are causing the devastation and terrorizing our neighborhoods. And the police have a role to play, the government has a role to play, and the community has a role to play. And we all have to get on the same page. And that page isn't standing around pointing fingers. That page is coming together and saying that we want to work together to have a safer community. And the month that we had in May was devastating. And the work that we're doing every single day to bridge the gap between the community and the police, using all of the resources that we have available to us to make sure that the police officers have what they need to get out there and be aggressive in our efforts to reduce violence in our city. We're doing that every single day. There's no dispute that we had an incredibly horrible.
Can you understand our anger, though? Can you understand the frustration to where we're working on providing police the assets they need? We're working on realizing and figuring out where these issues are from. But how do you tell the people that are dead? How do you tell the families of the people that are dead? To them, it doesn't matter. Josh asked the question, do you feel like you owe us an apology? As someone that lives in Baltimore and smelled the buildings burning and had a family trapped in his house with them, I feel like I'm owed one. I feel like I'm owed one by you. I feel like I'm owed one by Bats. I feel like I'm owed one by your cabinet. Because I had a family visit me. And you're talking, I'm just a citizen here, just talking to his leader. I had a family visit Baltimore for the first time ever during all that stuff. And they were trapped in my place. And it sucked. And I still live downtown. I still love the city. I still want you to succeed at fixing this city.
Yeah, I mean, good luck. You have a big job ahead of you. I don't know how the hell you're going to do it. I mean, you got the fuss of 2015. We like to call it a riot. You will call it an uprising, but whatever. And now you have all of these murders in one month. So it's like, I don't know how this gets fixed or how it's going to be better, but you got a lot of work ahead of you.
And we do appreciate you taking the time this morning to talk with us. I have to reinforce that. Thank you for that.
Well, I appreciate giving me the opportunity to address it. I share your frustration, your anger. The notion that I don't, I think, is certainly not reflected of the work that we've been doing. You know, I've been having these conversations with the community. I've been doing this work every day with the police. It's been a horrible month. But I guarantee that it's not out of control. we've seen in instances where the police officers have been involved in shootings and shootings and have been charged in other jurisdictions around the country, that has come with an increase in violence, and which also come with a period where that violence has calmed down. And my commitment is to do that work that needs to be done every day to get this under control and to do it in a way that is sustainable in our efforts to move the city forward. And I beg all of the community that wants Baltimore to be safer to work with us to make it so. We're not going to arrest our way out of this issue. It's not something that the police can do by themselves. It has to be something that the police does with the community. And my goal is to make sure that we get there. We've seen significant reductions in violent crime under my administration, and I'm committed to make sure that we get there again.
And Madam Mayor Stephanie Rawlings-Blake, all of us in this room hope you do get there for our sake, for your sake,
for the city's sake
of Baltimore. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
Morning.